It's always a joy in our house when I come home and there's Leah J music playing and resonating through the house. So, Leah, it's wonderful to have you here.
Thank you. I'm going to start with a song that celebrates the diversity of the spiritual gifts called We Are One.
One preaches the word while one kneels to pray. Another speaks loudly for those crying out for the light of the day. One touches and heals. One teaches the truth. One stands in the street for all passing to see and shouts, Jesus loves you. We each need each other. I am one small piece in the puzzle. I am one little brick in the wall. I am one brush stroke on a canvas that stretches from age to age. I am just one. I am just one. One patiently waits on the Lord with great faith, believing the answer is yes and amen for the prayers of the saints. Another discerns for the good of the church. Another is wise and another cries out, praising angelic words. We each need each other. I am one small piece in the puzzle. I am one little brick in the wall. We are one brush stroke on a canvas that stretches from age to age. I am one light shining in darkness. You are one blade of grass in a field. We are one grain of sand on a shoreline that reaches forever. We are one holy church, one royal priesthood, one chosen people of God. One part of a body with Christ as the head, and He is leading us home, where we'll be one beautiful bride for the Master, clothed in a garment of white, radiant, glowing, and transformed from darkness to marvelous light. We'll have 1 billion guests at the banquet, and the angels will sing to the sun. And all of us gathered together will finally be one. We are one small piece in the puzzle. We are one little brick in the wall. We are one brush stroke on a canvas that stretches from age to age. We are one light shining in darkness. We are one blade of grass in a field. We are one. We are one. And we each need each other. Yes, we are one. Yes, we are one.
You'll see up there that the Apostle Paul talks a lot about the giftedness of the Spirit and how we can infer from studying these three key passages on the subject that no one Christian has all the spiritual gifts, but every believer filled with the Spirit is given at least one gift, and the purpose of the gifts is twofold, to edify the body of Christ and to glorify the head of the church. Christ. So what I want to talk to you about today is music in the context of diverse worshiping communities. I would like to call my talk 10 Easy Steps to Ticking Off Every Member of Your Congregation. Because there's nothing more divisive than music styles and the music wars and all of that stuff. I've been through it. I've been around. I'll tell you a little bit about myself, my background, and particularly in the ministry of young adults. What I want to say is kind of my experience as a worship leader in blended worship communities when I was a young adult. Full confession, I turned 38 on Tuesday, so I'm no longer qualified to be a young adult according to the age range at NIAC. And there's nothing between NIAC and NOAC, people. What's up with that? I got to wait 13 more years before I can go to National Older Adult Conference, unless they bring me to sing. Hint, hint. Any of you on the planning committee? You're too young. The young adults, and so I'm kind of that middle age range, but I became a music minister when I was 18. So I went to Indiana University of Pennsylvania to study music, and I was there one semester and then transferred to a Christian college in Arkansas, Harding University. And while I was at Harding University, which is a Church of Christ school, as a member of the Church of the Brethren, where do you think I worshiped? Of course, the Lutheran Church. So I went to the Lutheran Church because I just was visiting churches, and I wrote down a list of churches I had passed. And I was just going to go Sunday after Sunday until I found one. Literally, the first day I walked into the Lutheran church, they found out that I was a piano major with a minor in theory and composition. And 2 days later, I got a call in my dorm room from this lady, Vanna. Leah, my name is Vanna, and you are an answer to prayer. And she called to say that she has to have a surgical procedure over Christmas, and they need somebody to accompany their cantata. And will you let us pay you $25 a week to come and rehearse with our choir and play the cantata? I'm a broke college kid. Heck yeah. So I signed on, and I never left. 4 years I worshiped at that church. And I stayed on, and we ended up, while I was there, and they were like hearing me play and my musical style, I had grown up in congregations where we practiced blended worship. And so I was comfortable playing all the Hillsong songs, and I was comfortable playing all the Maranatha choruses from the 80s and 90s, and I could play me some Andre Crouch, and then I could play the hymns. And put that all together, and they're like, great, we want to do a Lutheran liturgical worship service with contemporary music. And we want to be a blended contemporary liturgical community in a farm in Arkansas. I'm on board. We'll try it. Let's give it a shot. And so for 4 years, I worshiped at Our Shepherd Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod in Searcy, Arkansas, and kind of cut my teeth on music ministry and leadership and just increasing my love for and appreciation of diversity of music that's coming out of Christendom in my lifetime and in my parents' lifetime. Go to the next slide, please. This is a sampling of what my church looks like. So I'm the minister of music at Harrisburg First Church of the Brethren in beautiful downtown Allison Hill. Allison Hill is the poorest community between Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. We are surrounded by urban decay, broken infrastructure, gun violence, substance abuse, tremendous poverty, food insecurity, and public education systems that have seeped out most athletic programs, most music programs, most extracurricular activities, one by one by one, which just leaves our teenagers wandering on the street, looking for something to do, getting into trouble. This particular team of people you're looking at are the volunteers who work with local teens through a program that is sponsored by On Earth Peace and was created by a retired minister from my congregation, Gerald Rhodes, called Agape Satyagraha. Agape being God love, the love of God, the pure, unadulterated spiritual love that we receive from God. And Satyagraha, which was a term for justice and nonviolence used by Gandhi. And the two pieces are together. So they teach conflict mediation skills, conflict transformation, de-escalating violent situations, intervening in violent situations, de-escalating their own anger moods, learning how to process their negative emotions in healthy ways and directing that negativity into more healthy channels so that they can break the cycle of violence and negativity that they're immersed in on a daily basis. Flip to the next screen. Hi, Belita. That's my beautiful pastor. I love her. She's a woman of God and a woman of prayer, and she bathes that city in prayer. She is not only the leader and figurehead of our congregation, but she is also the chief spokesperson for Heeding God's Call, which is a national program to end gun violence. Harrisburg has only 53,000 people in it. We've had 7 murders since Christmas. So per capita, even though you hear of other cities like Baltimore and Miami and Chicago and LA having higher numbers of the dead, per capita, Harrisburg is one of the most violent places in the United States. Next slide. This is our mission statement in my context. Harrisburg First Church of the Brethren is called to be a Christ-centered, multicultural community in the inner city, sharing the love, healing, peace, and justice of Jesus. That's our ministry context. And for decades now, our church in 2016 is celebrating its 120th anniversary. But it's only been multicultural for about 30 years. And what I'll say is it's only had the vision of being multicultural for 30 years. It's only been multicultural for about 6. And that's with an African-American pastor. And other people of various races. We have Asians and a couple of Latino or Hispanic people worshiping in our congregation. And then the rest are about half African-American and half Caucasian or mixed race. And in leadership. But even though in the worshiping body there's diversity, in the leadership of the church, there's still the old stronghold of the white suburban people who drove in from outside the city, and they've held those positions of influence and power and authority for like 30, 40 years. I got hired in July. We've already had 4 deaths in the congregation. All of them were aging white members in leadership. We've lost 4 board members and deacons and Sunday school teachers and people who were really, really kind of powerhouse influences over the congregation. So it's an interesting time for me to kind of come on board and learn all of this personality of our community and my congregation, because on one hand, we're grieving. And as a body of believers, we're grieving these losses. On the other hand, we're seeing suddenly there's this tremendous potential for passing the baton to new leaders, leaders that will reflect the diversity of our community. Our general goal in everything we do is to live out this mission. And this mission says we want our inside to look like our outside. We want our worshiping community on the inside of the walls to reflect the diversity of the community right outside our doors. And that includes our music ministry. Next slide, please. So I want you to show you some of the things. This is not my whole job description, but these are literal phrases taken from my job description. As I was being hired, this is what they were looking for in a minister of music. Knowledge in music from varied traditions. Knowledge and experience directing a choir and leading contemporary worship. I totally agree with you, Brother Adam, about the term contemporary and its ineffectiveness, but it is sort of ingrained in us, and you all understand what I mean by contemporary. It means the music that could have a bass or a drum attached to it, right? Sensitivity to brethren theology. That's a caveat that immediately excludes a wide assortment of applicants for the position. Sensitivity to varied cultural norms. Next slide. There's more. Worship, planning, diverse musical taste, ability to play a lead instrument, lead congregational singing, introduce new music, including hymns, ethnocentric genres, and contemporary songs, and be prepared to teach and preach on the role of music in the church. That is a short list. Thank you, Jesus, that I have a job. That's amazing. But really, we're in our collective culture as church, unlike during the Renaissance era, unlike the Reformation era, the church is not at the forefront mainstream churches are not at the forefront of developing musical talent and musical leadership. We are expecting our public education system to do that. Guess who's not doing it? So it's not getting done. We have an entire generation of people who have a God-given innate talent for music and a passion for music that can't read music or interpret music or read chords or play an instrument or develop a stage presence that helps them to be leaders. I'm a big believer, big believer that churches should be budgeting money in a line item specifically for paying for private lessons for young people in your congregation. In addition to paying guest musicians, paying your musicians, or at least buying music, you know, even if you don't have a person staffed in that role, you still budget money for music software or chord charts or your CCLI license and all these things. In addition to that, we ought to be taking our prophetic role as the people who are reclaiming music for the Lord. It's a gift from Him in the first place, and we have the potential to redeem it and raise up a generation of young teens and young adults who will be music leaders in our churches and skillful musicians. Because Psalm 33, we heard that quoted yesterday, but it doesn't just sing a new song. It says, sing a new song, play skillfully, and shout for joy. So we ought to be making a deliberate, intentional, committed effort at developing skill, so that the quality of our music is excellent, so that everything we're presenting to the Lord is done with excellence. Next slide. I want you to look at these three objects. Which one has the most value? This is a model I use repeatedly when I'm facing congregations that are like me in some sort of singular music model. Maybe they're doing exclusively modern music, like cutting edge, hot off the press music, or maybe they're doing exclusively hymns from their particular denominational perspective, and they call me to say, we want to do more. So there's this whole movement now in the emergent church to embrace ancient future, that sort of merging past and present best practices. So we'd get a church like Chris Monahan's would call me and say, you know, we've been doing all this modern music and it's great and the theology sound, but we have people worshiping in our community who really miss the hymns. Can you teach us how to modernize those or how to blend those into our worship service so that we can offer a more diverse musical expression? Or we have communities that have been suffering from that urban sprawl or shrinking city phenomenons that we've seen, the culture shifts. As we've become less and less industrialized, businesses move. When businesses move, the jobs move. When the jobs move, the families move. And the same people that used to fill your rural sanctuary or your suburban sanctuary, you know, now they don't look the same. They don't eat the same food as you. They weren't born speaking the same language as you, but you are their community church. So what are you going to do to reach them with the gospel of Jesus Christ? Music is a wonderful vehicle that we can use. It's a tool that God has given us, not only to express praise and glory to God and to build up our own spirits and edify our souls, but also as an evangelistic tool. It's a gateway to reach the hearts of other people who might not want to be preached at, but they'll listen to some good music. You know, next slide. So this is a list of what a typical service at Harrisburg First Church of the Brethren has to have. That I have to on a weekly basis. Now, there are times when we maybe have something extra going on in the service, like we serve bread and cup communion the first Sunday of each month at our blended service. So in that time, I'm allowed to cut something. But very rarely. So as I'm thinking through, here's the scripture text for the week, here's what pastor's preaching on, or here's the season of the church calendar that we're honoring at the moment, Plus, here are the languages spoken in our congregation. Here are the age demographics in our congregation. Here are the diverse musical styles that each particular individual loves to have. And because we want our insides to reflect our outsides, we have to also be thinking about who might walk in the door today that's never been there before, and what can we offer them that resonates with them at a personal level. So on a weekly basis, not necessarily in this particular order, I need to introduce at least one hymn. I can do that in a creative or fresh way. You know, we could sing. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Or I could do, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. And do something a little different with it, but it's still the idea of something familiar that any person from any church tradition, the person who walks in the door at 40 years of age who hasn't been in church since their grandmother was taking them when they were 11, will recognize soon and very soon. They'll know it. They'll recognize Amazing Grace. Southern gospel. Interestingly, I have a drummer who plays Southern gospel, and so pretty much every song we do as a praise band turns into Southern gospel. He does the best he can. God bless him. But it's not always intentional, but we do a lot of boom chum, boom chum, boom chum, boom chum. This is the day. This is the day. Only we have some people with rhythm who clap on the offbeat. This is the day. And then we have the white folk who are like, this is the day. So you get like two competing. Bump. This is... That's what we hear. But that's okay, because everybody's allowed, you know, like Kayla said, you know, no judgment. You can keep whatever beat the Lord gave you. Have you ever seen the movie The Jerk, when Steve Martin is like... Yeah, that's about it. We want to have traditional black gospel, because that's language our pastor and her generation speak. So they grew up listening to Mahalia, and they grew up listening to Andre, and they grew up singing spirituals. That's their heart language. When I start the song, I want Jesus to walk with me, you just see Pastor's eyes close, and she gets immediately transported. That song just carries her to a place that's very comfortable and familiar and safe, and she just lets loose. But then we also have 20 people in our youth group that are all mixed race or African American or Asian. There's one adopted Asian girl in our youth group. And so they're listening to Ty Trabet. They're listening to Lecrae. So what can we do to give them something that they're sitting in church saying, yes, they're speaking my language. Eurocentric American praise and worship. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Great song, nothing wrong with it. Every white American Christian knows it. Right? Spanish. We sing and we read scripture in Spanish. We have language limitation in our pastoral staff, but we can sing it. So I sing Spanish very well. I just don't speak it very well. I'm always trying to struggle conjugating verbs and where my adjectives go and all that business. I'm getting better at it because my stepmother is from the Dominican Republic. And I don't want to sit there with my Google Translate app to talk to her. So I'm learning some more conversational Spanish. But I love to sing in Spanish. I think it is a beautiful language. And you'll hear that today. Because what we're about to do... And including a Maranatha praise chorus, of course, you know, which is like a hymn, only you don't sing in four-part harmony. But there's the structure, and there's a beginning, and there's an end, and it tells a complete story, and it's intact. So it has closer to a hymn structure than a modern. It's almost like the bridge or the hybrid that bridged the hymn culture to the modern worship culture, or were that decade and a half or so of those Integrity's Hosanna and Maranatha music that was coming out in the 80s and 90s. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. We all know that one. I'm sick of that song. But we know it, and we do it at my church because they still love it. So what you and I are going to do, since you've been so warmed up and so good at worshiping this weekend, and I'm just getting a lot out of the music over the weekend. I love every person's individual presentation has taken me to a different place. And you can see that in my own background. I praise God that I was raised by parents who had an appreciation for cultures besides their own. And so my brother and I were exposed to many different languages and rhythms and song styles at a very early age. One of my earliest memories of church music was a woman named Lucy Wood at the Indiana Church of the Brethren in Indiana, Pennsylvania. My dad was the pastor there for 13 years, and I was born in that congregation, lived there till I was 12. And my earliest memories were Lucy had a talent for prophetic songwriting. And so she would listen to the sermon and be toward the back of the room digesting what was being preached or what the scripture was for the day, and she would write a very simple chorus, and she played violin. So sometimes she would just stand up and say, God gave me this song that to help me like remember what we've been learning today. And she would pull out her violin and play a very simple little repetitive melody. It was nothing complicated about it. It wasn't fancy, but it was immediately for the moment. Most of those songs never got published, and most of them never got used outside of our context. But in that day, there was a new song being given to our church, and we would all sing it through four or five times and begin to feel like we learned it. And that was how we would conclude our worship services. It was wonderful, wonderful gift. And a wonderful tradition that I wish we would recapture. So we're going to, they're not in this order, but I really do, in the songs that I've selected, have an example of every single one of those things. Now, we don't do it all in one big chunk. We have a greeting time at our church where everybody in the room who wants an ORF rhythm instrument, I mean, it gets like really crazy. Not only can't they clap on beat, but then you put a tambourine in their hands. And kids, every child in the room gets an instrument. Every adult that wants one gets an instrument. And we spend a good 5 minutes at the beginning of the service leaving our seat and walking around and greeting and welcoming and passing peace to one another and encouraging the children in worship. And they take a good chunk of time. So we always have one of those oompa songs going on in the background to get us started. And people play their instrument and they walk around and dance and talk to each other. And then we'll do our welcome and announcements. And then we'll have a worship set. And that's kind of that middle section. And then later on, we'll do some music at the close. That's every Sunday, we invite people up to the altar who want prayer, and deacons and pastors in the room come forward and offer prayer for people. That's a standing tradition in our church. So sometimes when the Spirit's moving and people are coming forward to pray, I have been there since July. I've never been there on a Sunday when somebody didn't come up for prayer. It's just a habit in our church to take that invitation and take advantage of it. And so sometimes, you know, we start at 11:15-ish, kind of on island time. So sometimes it's 11:20, 11:25. And it's not uncommon for me not to get out of church until 1:30. Because we're not on a time constraint, you know. So I want you to turn to the neighbor next to you and say, hips, thou art loosed. You are allowed to move freely. If you have a, you can clap, snap, or stomp. There are a few instruments around the room for anybody who wants to play. You're allowed to get up from your seat and move to the music. Some of what we'll do is upbeat, and then we'll kind of bring it down a notch, you know. Feel free to sit at any time, but I do encourage you to begin standing at least. And this is what we do at Harrisburg First. We just want you to worship. We are in community in the room. And so just by virtue of that and raising your voices together, this is community worship, but it's also individual worship. It's not either or, it's both and. So we want you to take advantage of that. Lord, you are good, sing. Lord, you are good. Your mercies endureth forever. Lord, you are good, yeah. Lord, you are good, and your mercies endureth forever. People from every nation, people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Oh,
for who you are. You are what? You are good. We're going to pick up the tempo a little bit, okay? Follow me. Lord, you are good. Say, Lord, you are good and your mercies endureth forever. Lord, you are good, yeah, Lord, you and your mercies. Let him know how good he is, yeah. People from every nation and, hey, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you for who you are. You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are, ladies, you are, men, all the time, men, ladies, you are good, ladies. You are men. Ladies. Lord, you are good, yeah. Lord, you are good and your mercies endureth forever. Oh, Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good. And we're going to sing that again. And just bless the Lord right now. Tell him how good he is. Lord, you are good and your mercies endureth. Lord, you are good, yeah. People from every nation, from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. You. Oh, so good, so good, yeah. Get big finish. You are good. This song says, you're the reason for my adoration. You're my motive for living, Lord. It says, you're my light and my salvation. You are strong and mighty. You are all powerful. You are invincible and there is nobody like you. That's what we're going to sing. La única razón de mi adoración eres tú, mi Jesús. Mi único motivo para vivir eres tú, mi Señor. Mi única verdad está en ti, eres mi luz y mi salvación. Mi único amor eres tu Señor y por siempre te alabaré. Tú eres todo poderoso.
Next slide.
Eres grande, majestuoso. Eres fuerte, invencible y no hay nadie como tú.
Eres todo poderoso.
Eres todo poderoso, eres grande, majestuoso, eres fuerte, invencible, y no hay nadie como tú.
From the beginning,
la única razón de mi adoración, eres tú, mi Jesús. Mi único motivo para vivir eres tú, mi Señor. Mi única verdad está en ti. Eres mi luz y mi salvación. Mi único amor eres tu Señor y por siempre te alabaré.
You are all powerful. You are grand and majestic. You are strong, invincible, and there is no one like you. I love that song. Man, on to the next slide. We're just going to keep right on going. Here's our Maranatha piece. Thank you, Sandy Patty. We're going to keep singing about the strength and power of the Lord.
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord. There is hope in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord. There is hope in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is he.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
We share in one of my favorite scriptures that honors and glorifies the person of Jesus Christ is from the book of Colossians. The next screen, please. Read this with me. Christ is the invisible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. I invite you to be seated. We're just going to keep right on going because we haven't tackled all of our genres yet. We're only about halfway through. This is in the hymnal if you want to follow along. Oh, and I meant to check the lyrics before I published this, and I forgot to, so I hope the screen's right. But I'm going to invite Kayla up here with me. We're just going to take turns leading you all with the verses. We're going to do it in a key, not the key it's written in the hymnal, but the key we do it in at Harrisburg First, where we don't have a lot of harmony singers. And so I'll talk in a minute about tools that you need to keep in mind for blended worship. One of them is the singability of the songs and putting them in keys that an average non-trained singer can do. So this is what we're going to do with this one. Now that we know who Christ is, don't you want him with you? This is a fun ad-lib song. In my trials, Lord, walk with me. Walk with me. In my trials, Lord, walk with me.
us to walk with me. When I'm in trouble, Lord, walk with me. When I'm in trouble, Lord, walk with me. When my head is bowed and breaking, Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me. Walk with me, Lord, walk with me. Walk with me, Lord, walk with me. All along my pilgrim journey, Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me.
Walk with me.
Walk with me, Lord, walk with me. Walk with me, Lord, please walk with me. When my long, my pilgrim journey, Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me.
All along,
all along journey, Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me.
We want you, Lord.
Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me.
One more time.
Lord, I want Jesus to walk with me.
I'm going to keep right on going with a Brooklyn Tabernacle song that I love that talks about what God has done in my life and who God has been for me. And it makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Just take any worship posture you feel as we're lifting up the name of Jesus and thanking him for his Holy Spirit. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. We're gonna do all that again. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, you know it makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. You know it makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed on solid ground, you know it makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Oh, you know it makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Just the voices. It makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. You know it makes me wanna shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout. Give God offering today of thanks and praise. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. I'm going to sing the first and last stanza of this. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Shadow of
peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
I invite you to be seated for this next song. This is one of my favorite singer-songwriters, Sarah Groves. This is off her album, Conversations. This is what she did with that song.
Morning by morning, I wake up to find the power and comfort of God's hand in mine. Season by season, I watch him amazed in awe of the mysteries of his perfect ways. All I have need of, his hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. I can't remember a trial or a pain he did not recycle to give me gain. I can't remember one single regret in serving God only and trusting his hand. All I have need of, his hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. This is my anthem, this is my song, the theme of the stories I've heard for so long. God has been faithful, he will be again. His loving compassion, it knows no end. His hand will provide. He's always been faithful. He's always been faithful. He's always been faithful to me.
One more time, church.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever. Great is thy faith.
For those of you in ministry, in music, or in leadership in your church, I want to give you just a few tips to follow or things to keep in mind as you are being intentional about multicultural, blended worship and some of the considerations that must be made in order to accommodate as many people as possible and to make it easy for people to enter into worship. We don't want our church services to be a barrier for people finding the Lord if they're looking for him. You know, we want to do everything we can to usher them in and make that process, you know. And the first tip is you as the leader, you as the pastor, the worship leader, the church musician, doesn't matter what instrument, doesn't matter what part you're singing, if you're on stage in front of everybody, rule number one, you must worship. You must be a worshiper. You can't lead people where you're not willing to go. So you have to be walking into the throne room in order to be able to usher people into that place. Number two, if the content is poor, or if it's too wordy, or if it sounds unnatural to the verbiage of your community, don't use it. You have 50 billion songs to choose from. So you don't need to use that one. Find a song that says the exact same thing a better way for your context. It doesn't matter how much you love it. It doesn't matter that your favorite band is the one that recorded it. You can like be riding down the road and jamming out to anything Crowder ever sang, but if it's not congregational in nature and it doesn't lend itself to congregational use, don't try it to make it fit where it doesn't belong. There are a lot of reasons people write Christian songs, and not all of it is to get everybody singing the exact same words and melody at the same time. All right. Number two, we talked about this just earlier. Put it in a singable key. Good guideline for that is here's middle C. So look at all the notes in your song and make sure it doesn't go, try not to let it go any higher than the E an octave above, because any higher than that, only the first sopranos and first tenors can sing it. And here's middle C again. Try not to get it to go any lower than an A an octave below, because then your basses and your altos can't sing it. You need to keep in the middle of that range so that it's in a singable key. That is particular to unison singing. That's a big, big go-to rule for unison singing. And you'll see in our hymnal, we've got Fs and F sharps and Gs all over the place, you know, because we're a singing church and we can handle that. And when you're in a church that's singing hymns in four-part harmony, you'll always have people in the room who can tackle those big notes. But when we're talking about an African-American spiritual or a contemporary worship chorus or a Southern gospel chorus, and you're not going to have part singing, keep it in a singable range. The minute you make it too high and it hurts people's voices, or too low and it hurts people's voices, guess what they stop doing? And the whole point of congregational singing is that the praise team's not the only ones doing it. We want as many people participating as possible. Number three, get to know your congregation. That sounds like a duh, but you'd be surprised how many worship leaders just assume everybody in the room likes exactly what they like. And so every song I pick, you just like go on the assumption this is a good song and I prayed about it and this is the one that I'm comfortable with and I think we should do it, but you don't actually know your demographic. So one thing that I've done it at my church when I was a pastor in Florida, I know that Scott Duffy has done it at Stanton congregation in Virginia. He had his congregation write down their favorite praise and worship song, or in Scott's case, it was hymns. Mine was a little broader than I was like any song that leads you to feel, the presence of God or the power of God, or it's been meaningful in your faith walk. And then we preached a sermon series where each sermon was based on the content and the biblical foundation for that song. And so we educated people who didn't know hymns about the background of the hymns and the theology of the hymns. And we educated the hymn lovers who couldn't care less about your love never fails, never give, because they think it's too repetitive. And suddenly you go, oh, but the word love is repeated a lot in scriptures. Then it's okay to repeat it. And here's where we can. And so it was a great way to break down the preconceived notions and barriers that we have and kind of our strong opinions of our sacred music, my favorite version of music, when you begin to learn what what you are able to appreciate about other music. Another thing was talk through any stigmas you already know are there before you even introduce the song. Just name the elephant in the room, get it out of the way. You know, we're about to teach you a song. It's going to have a real beat. You know, I want to make sure that you're like sitting on that backbeat, guys. And it's not going to be what we're used to, but I want you to pay attention to it because here's what the lyrics say. Or here's how it fits into the sermon today or something. And you just name the elephant in the room and you break down that stigma so that it's not, that way people don't have an expectation that doesn't get met. Now you're helping them to actually have an expectation and it's realized. And I think more than anything, people get hung up over music when their expectations aren't realized. Perfect illustration of that is I went to a Jars of Clay concert one time and a band called Three Crosses opened for them. And I had never heard of Three Crosses before. They came on stage and performed their short little set as the opening act, and the crowd went crazy. We loved them. We were like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. And I looked at my friend. I was like, I gotta get their album. So I went out to the merchandise table at the end of the concert. I bought the album. I put it in my player. It was terrible. Terrible production quality. Sounded like they had recorded in a tin can. Like it was nothing like the stage show. So they had like elevated my level of expectation. I expected that I was going to be able to carry that same feeling with me and play it over and over again in my Walkman. But I didn't get to. It was kind of a letdown. And something about that, the stigma thing or just people's strong opinions. I had a worship professor at Ashland Seminary, Ron Sprunger. He's from the Mennonite tradition. He was the music teacher at Ashland for a while. And he said that he's had this happen frequently. Like he'll introduce a new style of song to a church that's never heard it before. And inevitably somebody at the end of the service will walk up to him as they're leaving the sanctuary and be like, I didn't like the song today. And his response is, that one wasn't for you. Think about it. Not every song will speak to every person at the same level every time. So if you have complainers in your church and people who are voicing those strong opinions, just remind them there are other people in the room for whom that was a real blessing. Practice makes excellent. I mentioned that Psalm 33 verse, play skillfully. I am convinced that a lot of what is construed as bad songs is actually probably poorly executed songs. And that people who say they don't like the hymns because there's an organ accompanying them, it's probably because there's an organist that doesn't know how to operate the organ. Or there are people who don't like the contemporary songs because they have a guitar player that can only play in three chords. And they're just limited to what they can offer the congregation. So improving the skill of your musicians and expanding their horizons is a blessing to the whole congregation. And this goes back to what I said earlier about making sure that we as the church are facilitating music leadership development. And then always remember, you as the leader, you as the worship leader, the singer, the drummer, doesn't matter what role you're playing, if you're on the platform leading people, the goal is not to get everybody in the room to like the songs. The object is to get everyone in the room to love God and love each other more than they did the last time we were together. So if your music can do that, as leaders and church musicians, we can do that right, and it has a real unifying effect on the congregation. But if we allow the divisive parts of the music or the complaints about the music or the strong opinions or just lack of discernment or poor quality, on and on, you can get it, any of the negative stuff, then what do we hear yesterday? Our church does more harm than good. We don't want to be that church. Young adults in this country more than ever before care about relationship. And your music should not be breaking down the quality of relationships in your church. They should be building those up and affirming them. And then the last thing is, scripture is loaded with examples of ancient, modern, transcendent, imminent, exultant, penitent, individual, corporate, young, old, foreign, domestic worship experiences. There's something for everybody. Adam didn't know God the same way Moses did, and Moses didn't worship God the same way Solomon did, and Solomon had a different music to sing in his congregation than Timothy did as a young pastor. The Ethiopian eunuch that Philip baptized went back to Ethiopia and probably made up new songs because he hadn't learned the ones in Jerusalem. He didn't even speak that. That wasn't even his native language. At Harrisburg, our mission is to be a Christ-centered, multicultural community in the inner city, sharing the love, healing, peace, and justice of Jesus Christ. We want our music to reflect that, and there's real richness in that. If we're going to do that effectively, we need to allow into our worship assembly as much diversity of music as there is diversity of people. And each one then can find an expression to praise the Lord, and then all of us can praise the Lord together. Thank you.